Greetings and Happy New Year! Maybe you remember me installing a rack into my former bomb shelter, now museum, for installing some retro network gear. But since it's all but 40 centimeters concrete walls, there's no way to feed in a network cable. The community has provided ample of suggestions, ranging from PowerLine to WiFi bridges and whatnot, and today we'll be exploring some of it in this New Year's special episode. Let's talk about legacy network technology. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. So before we get to the gear, here's the console of a FreeBSD jail I just set up, where I'm now going to install IPERF 3, because I'm not satisfied if I just happen to get a network connection, I want to assert how much throughput I can achieve. Word of warning, when installing IPERF 3 on FreeBSD, you won't get any kind of init scripts or anything. Archaic as it is, you'll have to create a simple init script like this one yourself and place it into /user/local/etc/rc.d/iperf3. Don't forget to set the exec permissions. As usual for FreeBSD, the RC script has to be registered in /etc/rc.conf for automatic startup. The way it's configured, it's set up to listen on TCP and UDP ports 5201 and apply no bandwidth limits. And here we go with a brief test, showing that I can easily attain a rate over 940 megabits per second, which is pretty much the maximum you can squeeze out from a gigabit network. That's more than enough, as I'm talking about hooking up a legacy Ethernet network running on 10 or a maximum of 100 megabits per second. When reading about PowerLine, or HomePlug AV as it's also called, you'll hear many times about how problematic it can be. And although my experience with PowerLine was never good, it's definitely an option to explore. I still had these two TP-Link units in my stocks. For the initial demo, I'll connect them to the same circuit on an expansion rail. I know this is not recommended, but for the first kickstart it will suffice. Luckily, this software is still available on the TP-Link website, and once installed, it shows both units right away. And they synchronized with 460 megabits, which is just short below their rated speed of 500 megabits. Running IPERF shows a plus minus constant rate close to 100 megabits.
Wait a second, didn't you say these things are rated for 500 megabits?
True, but that's only for the interconnection between the PowerLine adapters. The actual client-facing Ethernet ports are rated for 100 megabits only. So I then plugged one unit into the wall plug inside my bomb shelter. It's no big secret that PowerLine adapters don't like crossing circuits. Still, I tried it first like this, knowing that the results would be mediocre at best. This is a power strip located in my rack, and again, yes, I'm well aware that one should not install it like this. And the penalty becomes imminently visible, as it only synchronizes at 16 megabits. In reality, it's much worse, as I only get somewhere around 5 megabits pushed through, with quite some drops even down to 1 megabit. And then I wanted to use that wall plug up there. While it still is on a different circuit, it should fare better. But unfortunately, due to the other cables plugged in, the power line adapter couldn't be properly seated. So I quickly hooked it up on an extension wire, which again is not recommended best practice. At least, it would synchronize to somewhere around 66 megabits, giving me a much better transfer rate of roughly 29 megabits actually pushed through, with a lot less spread in the test results. To compare, here's another wall plug, which I knew is on the same circuit. My wife would certainly love to see that as a permanent installation here besides her iron. But I'm only after seeing what bandwidth I can attain, and not surprising, I get back into a sync speed in the 400 megabits range. I even tried another one, which was a bit farther but still on the same circuit, syncing in on around 300 megabits. That's still enough to attain a constant 100 megabits rate when measured with iPerf. But given those wall plugs are nowhere close to the network rack, it doesn't solve my problem, as I then still would need to have flying network cables. So what about a Wi-Fi bridge then? As a coincidence, I also had this Revision 1 TP-Link Wi-Fi extender laying around. Released in 2014, it's not really vintage, but it's definitely old and outdated tech.
You do know it's mounted the wrong way round. That's not what the manual says.
I know, and if I get it working, I will fix that in a second step. What I want is to use the extender as a wireless adapter so it connects my network over the air while having everything on the wire inside my museum. I just performed the device reset beforehand, so now the extender would be reachable through its default IP address. But before I can continue, I have to prepare some things on my actual network first. Admittedly, I'm a Cisco person and I do run my network off Cisco gear. Thus far, I didn't bother to have my lab network on the Wi-Fi, but that's gonna change now. So I'll be adding a new VLAN, a matching layer 3 interface and a DHCP pool on my router. Then I have to pass the VLAN through the trunk ports heading down to my switch fabric. On the latter, I'll have to create the VLAN as well and permit it through the uplink interfaces to the router, but also into the direction of the access points. And last but not least, I'll add a new SSID on the access points so I can join it from the Wi-Fi extender. Said that, I ran through the setup wizard to join the network. I decidedly disabled the internal access point so the repeater wouldn't rebroadcast the SSIDs, as I don't want them to interfere with my existing Wi-Fi mesh. And while it did seem to work, I experienced some random and sudden disruptions as seen here. Even so, it would eventually reconnect after a power cycle, the problem kept persisting, so I eventually went to check for firmware updates.
I just want to add that doing firmware updates...
We don't discuss these things with outsiders. Look, the firmware update works just fine. And while I still would experience some jitter-causing variance in latency, it remained stable thus far, providing an adequate bandwidth of around 60 to 70 megabits. That's good enough for my retro gear. However, the way where it's currently set up, it's not the best of all places. So I tried relocating it down to the network rack. But as you can imagine, that wasn't the best of choices either, as the throughput dropped dramatically due to obstructions. So the place where it wasn't too bad after all, weren't it for the mounting orientation. So I'll have to swap the sockets to make it practically work. As always, when fumbling around on electric wiring, don't forget to switch the circuit breaker. Eventually, the wall plugs are flipped around and the Wi-Fi extender is plugged in the correct way. Alright, so now I have connectivity in my bomb shelter, now museum. Sort of. Fun fact, while it does work with a static IP address, it doesn't work with dynamic addressing using DHCP. That's most likely because of timing issues when using the Wi-Fi bridge. But that's a story for a different time. But as you have seen anyway, this consumer Wi-Fi bridge didn't leave the best of impressions after all. But maybe I could build a better Wi-Fi bridge myself. Of course, I could use this Raspberry Pi 1 from 2012, which in the meantime may qualify as vintage as well. But maybe I have something better. This is a PC Engine's Alex, which was released around, let me guess, 2007 or so. So it could be worthwhile exploring this as an alternative before I give in and might be using this flatband Ethernet cables, which I might just squeeze through here. And there's more shenanigans along the way, because what I've got here is a token ring card for a Cisco router. And this one should hopefully work with that monster over here, a Cisco 7300 router. And what about exploring 8-bit Ethernet cards that should go along well with the IBM PC or PCXT? So all this and more will be coming for 2025. And of course, that wouldn't be possible without your support, be it with a random gear donation or like your colleagues here who have opted for a permanent channel subscription. But even if you just subscribe to the channel, this is helping me already. And I've just recently broken through the 7,500 subscribers barrier. That's way more than I've ever anticipated. And the channel is growing day by day, and this is absolutely fantastic. And fear not, as promised early this year in summer 2024, I will be featuring some of these nuggets here, my ultra-mobile computing machines, and there's quite a few things to discover in this area. Anyway, I'm wishing you all the best for 2025, a thriving new year, all the best for you, your families, your friends and relatives, and I'm looking forward to having you on the channel again in the next year for my new upcoming episode next time, January 5, 2025. Thanks for watching and see you around.